radio. Here we are at I Am I Radio with What Keeps You Here. This is Virgil, and we're here in the studio with our special guest today, and his name is Mirek. Hello, Mirek, and welcome.
Hello, listeners.
How are you today, sir?
Sun is out. All my Facebook friends are instantly forgetting the horrors of the Polish winter.
Aha.
Everybody's in a good mood. Even the birds are singing.
Very, very nice. I know. I'm feeling a lot better myself these days. Once the sun comes out like that, everybody gets a little excited. Yeah?
Not only that, but I believe today's special for you, isn't it?
Oh, it's a special day for me, ladies and gentlemen. That's right. Today is my birthday.
Woo!
Yeah.
Stolat. Nie żyje, żyje nam.
Stolat. Nie żyje. Why is the non-Polish person singing this?
Because it is a multicultural,
expectation
challenging show.
Yeah.
Well done.
So, Mirek, let's start off by asking, who are you? Why are you here? What do you do?
I'm a fella who was born in Warsaw, and when I was a child under communism, along with my parents, we escaped Poland and moved to England, and where we became political asylum seekers, essentially.
Ah, okay.
So, so we sought refuge on the other side of Europe, and that was where I have lived, or where I lived for 30 years, on and off. Until about a year ago, when I decided it was high time to move to Poland, but not go back. I keep mentioning the fact that I didn't go back. I moved forward
to
my place of origin.
Uh-huh.
And so I'm here now doing all kinds of things, and I'm here to mention some of them and read some poems.
That is wonderful. All kinds of things, such as writing poetry.
I don't know. That's a misunderstanding.
Okay. That's all right.
I always have to clarify that. I run a publishing house. I work as a teacher. I have worked in publishing magazines, creative writing. I write fiction. I translate poetry. And I have run a lot of projects to do with excluded artists. So I guess if you're going to try and put that into one big bag, it would be about narrative arts with excluded communities. That's always been my bag.
Narrative arts with excluded communities.
Yeah.
That's beautiful. That is beautiful. Can you give me a specific example of one of these projects?
Yeah, I mean, in the last 5 years, I've run a center in central London for excluded writers.
Excluded writers.
Mm-hmm.
What does that mean?
It means anyone who we think is actually not finding it easy to become part of an establishment.
I see.
And of course, access to culture, access to the ability to express yourself isn't actually as easy as simply going on Twitter.
Uh-huh.
One needs resources, one needs support, one needs training. And I found that in London, because it's such a multicultural place, there was a lot of people, and it depends on your race, your ethnicity, your gender. I've done a lot of work with women artists in prison, with migrant women writers translating and publishing a lot of women. And of course, class. Class is something we find very difficult to talk about. And that's something which we really do have to talk about, because it actually affects all of us. You may not have an issue with gender, you may not have an issue with nationality, you may be where you are, you know, but class, especially related to income and wealth, is something which affects us all. And it's something these days we really need to talk about.
Did you find that in London you found much of this happening to a certain degree, enough of it happening where you felt you needed to give more exposure to these communities that are not being represented?
Well, my experience of, you know, landing in London in 1985, when there was not that many Polish people, certainly not as many as there are today, was very odd, because I had a very, I guess, lucky childhood in Poland, even though it was communism and there was nothing in the shops and there was, you know, serious oppression. There was no access to culture. Books were banned. It was a very, very dark time. But I came from a home where there was a lot of culture and there was a lot of intense talk about reality. And then when I landed in England and we ended up living in the worst part of London, you know, really in the slums, I suddenly felt excluded for the first time in my life, not just linguistically, but also culturally.
Uh-huh.
And I was a young white kid working very hard and studying very hard in a white world. But my name, my accent, you know, even my appearance were things that sort of singled me out. And I would never say that, for 30 years, I guess, I never experienced any discrimination directly. But I think there's lots of subtle forms of discrimination, which we should talk about.
That was my next question. Oh, yeah, sure,
definitely.
Yeah.
and bizarrely enough, you know, you end up with these kind of scenes where I was working in prison. I was. For a few years, I was teaching in prison. Then I became the head of equality. So in the biggest prison in Europe, I was responsible for human rights.
Okay. Wow.
In a place called Feltham Young Offenders, next door to Heathrow Prison, and terrible place with lots and lots of problems and lots of horrible histories. And my job was to support staff, support visitors, and of course support prisoners to make sure that they were treated fairly. And I remember I was going from work on my motorcycle to an event, a cultural event that I was running, you know, like with refugee artists. And then somebody cuts me up in the middle of London, this big old limo with you know, darked out windows. And I'm like, what's going on? And why is he cut me up? This guy is about to kill me. And the window goes down and there's a sort of young black guy sitting in there going, why don't you go back to your own country?
Oh,
yeah, with a sort of London accent, but not quite, slightly Jamaican. And I'm thinking to myself, what is going on here? Number one, my sister's married to a fella from Angola. They have a beautiful mixed race child. I've spent my whole life fighting discrimination and I'm wearing a black helmet. He can't see my face. How does he know? I was not born in this country. I was not born in London. And I realized I had a little sticker with a Polish eagle on the back. And I sort of realized, my God, you know, if he was whatever, you know, in a different situation, that could have got me killed.
Yeah.
And that was surprising, that suddenly something in England is changing for the worse. And I think that's true across Europe.
Mm.
And we really need to address some of that.
And I'm sure you are aware, as we are, that the same is happening in the United States. It's not just Europe. I feel like it's across the world, Mirek, actually. Across Europe, all the way down into Australia, all the way into the United States, Canada is beginning to have problems. It's a worldwide thing. What is your opinion on that? What is this movement into isolationism? This idea of, you know, everybody needs to go to their own little corner and create a little wall and protect themselves from some big bad
from the
wolf,
other.
Yeah. From the other.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, again, I have an opinion like anybody, and there is a rude saying that opinions are like backsides. Everybody has their own. Why would I be interested in yours?
Yeah.
Seeing yours, right? We could, I suppose, debate that, and we could look at all the different angles. And if I was going to look at it, I would look at the history of colonialism, actually. And I would ask myself, what is going on in my country of origin? Because I'm now a British citizen, and I feel, you know, like a complex creature, not just Polish, not just English. But I do believe that Britain and America more so, but you mentioned Australia, you mentioned Canada. There are huge problems with acknowledging that the empires of the West were not just created through hundreds of years of colonial exploitation, oppression, and destruction. But even today in Australia, even today in America, we are talking about the continual oppression and exploitation of substantial groups of people who are not basically originating from Europe. Let's put it that way, right? Because all these countries where there's white people on the other side of the planet, they got here from the, you know, the ports in Holland, the ports in England.
Mm-hmm.
And the reason we speak English in Canada, the reason we speak English in Australia and New Zealand is because they're migrants. Mm-hmm. And they seem to have gotten into their little heads that that's their home now, and they decide and they can make decisions that even involve horrible, horrible things to the natives, to the first Americans, to the Aboriginal people of the world, mm-hmm. that we have more rights than you.
This is
disturbing.
How do we bring it in accordance? Maybe that's not the best word. How do we bring it full circle? I absolutely agree with you in that mm-hmm. aspect. You have these people who are migrating to lands and then saying, you know, I'm going to put
this
a flag
ours.
Here.
Yeah.
So it's mine.
Uh-huh.
And when the others say, no, it's not yours, well, yeah, I'm going to kill you now, so I'm going to make sure it's mine. So the structure is set up to make sure that the power stays where it is. How do we break through that without military conflict?
Well, if you look at the great, I guess, influences of history, whether it's Malcolm X, who put it succinctly mm. when JFK was murdered, that his chickens coming home to roost.
Mm. Yeah.
Or whether it's Jesus Christ, you know, the original anarchist, Jewish anarchist, who I don't think had any intention. I have got a degree in comparative religion, so I speak with some authority when I say I don't think he had any intention of establishing a religious empire. They would not speak directly. They would not lecture. They would speak in parables. They would speak in metaphors. Mm. And I think it's really important that we use creativity, and I mentioned this idea of narrative arts, mm-hmm. to actually not start screaming at each other when somebody, you know, calls you back, you know, a racist name, or when somebody, I guess one example, when I was working in prison, and I had to teach young gangsters about equality. What does it mean? There's legislation, there's laws protecting your rights. And they are defined by various things like age, like discrimination, like disability, like your faith, and all these different things are protected. And it was all okay. It was all fine while we were talking about religion, we were talking about disabilities, ADHD, etc. And then we got on about sexuality. And I noticed that every time we started talking about the rights of people who choose to love people that are not conventional, sort of, you know, heterosexual relationships, that suddenly we don't just have maybe a lack of comfort. We end up with some opinions that start reaching for violence.
Mm. All right, aggression.
Absolutely. Uh-huh. And that lots and lots of young men around the world seem to think that it's okay to, you know, they're okay with religion. I think that lots of young people, generations, are now growing up in such multicultural environments that it's okay to have a different color of skin. But actually, sexuality is a big problem. We don't talk about it. Mm-hmm. And when I was in prison, and I had to talk about it because it was part of the training, I was facing serious violence because they were about to start attacking me.
Really?
For trying to convert them
to
their thinking,
tolerating and
trying
accepting.
To change them.
You're brainwashing us. You're trying to indoctrinate us.
And I noticed that this was a really, like, where you had to really talk your way out of something that could turn very nasty. And I would just say, gentlemen, it's about maths. The more gay men there are in the world, the more ladies there are for the rest of us. And you laugh.
And it worked.
They would just stop and start. You could hear their brains ticking, the little calculator going. Yeah. And I would ask them, you know, has anybody here been to a gay club? You know, you go out partying, blah, 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 you know, and somebody says, go, you know, and then you find that actually women feel more comfortable. The mm-hmm. music's better.
Uh-huh.
There's less aggro, mm-hmm. You know, and there's the women are willing to talk because they're not afraid of being drugged, etc. And eventually you get everybody kind of saying, well, you know what, actually, when I think about it, I don't know if I have a problem.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about it further. But you can't sort of preach to people. And the problem, I think, with a lot of what we've been observing recently with media, which is so quick, you know, social media, you know, is that people are coming out with statements without really wrapping them in an interesting angle, and mm-hmm. that does not work. And so the reason I translate poetry is because I actually think poetry in this age of fake news and post-truth is actually something that can make people think for themselves. I can't give you a poem that gives you the answers, but I can give you a poem that might make you stop and think about the question. And that in itself could be transformative.
Did you use the poetry in the prison system when you were working there?
I worked for many years as a creative writing tutor. I taught English, and I run a lot of initiatives such as magazines and events, cultural events. And I worked with the Anne Frank Trust. So we organized special training courses, okay, festivals based around the LGBT community, based around the GTR, so the Gypsy, Traveler, and Roma community, mm-hmm, and of course, Black History Month, you know, all those things. You really have to try and use the power of music and the power of storytelling to make people feel that they weren't just being preached to, and this wasn't just being done because the government says we have to now celebrate, you know.
I have to ask, and maybe I missed it, how did you first get involved in this type of work?
In the prison?
My first experience was at university. You know, I was working very hard, I was learning very hard, and I was still once a week, spending a day working in a psychiatric unit in Camden, working with people who were on sort of day release from care. I don't know if it's, you know, where this kind of sense of obligation of engagement, but as I reach, you know, some kind of period of wisdom where, you know, suddenly when I take a selfie or somebody takes a picture of me and puts it on Facebook, I'm suddenly thinking, how many gray hairs is that? Am I looking distinguished or am I looking old now? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I just think to myself, I didn't make myself. I didn't create myself. I didn't make this world. I am not here to make decisions on what belongs to me and what is right and wrong. I'm here to nurture. I'm here to shepherd certain things through existence. I'm here to get a job done, and it's a job which is in the name of others.
Mm-hmm.
And so translating poems rather than writing them to me is really important because it puts me in the role of somebody who converts and publishes and promotes the work of others rather than my own voice, mm-hmm, which I think is quite important.
Very good. You're listening to What Keeps You Here, and our special guest we have in the studio today, his name is Mirek, everybody. Mirek, I haven't said your surname, so I'm going to Kazmierski.
Well done.
Yeah, thank you.
Nice, you can do it.
Matic, it's not Mirek, it's Matic. Matic.
I like them all. I like there you go. I like all the versions. You know?
How about MK?
MK. We're going to take a short musical break soon. If you would like to ask questions to Matic or to either myself or DJ, feel free to do so by sending the question through our Facebook page at What Keeps You Here. Send us a message. Ask some questions. I have something special for you at the music break right now. We're going to play a song that is written, now this goes way back, so bear with me for a second. In the 80s, I was working with students in a place called Sheboygan, Wisconsin.
Sheboygan.
Yeah. And one of the students that I worked with, his name is Mike O'Neill.
Uh-huh.
Mike O'Neill has started a band that's presently in Colorado, I believe. And the name of the band is Bargain Bin Death Ray. Yeah. Bargain Bin Death Ray is the name of the band. Anyway, Mike had been listening to our show and asked if I could play one of his songs for him, and I would be happy to do so. The name of this song is Tubal Cain Blues. You are listening to What Keeps You Here.
Give me radio.
I was fine right in my footsteps, Johnny, indisposing, running, cause I didn't wanna tell the truth. My pants were on fire, I was breathing like a liar, I was reeling down in my shoes, yeah. Then all at once, jump up and kick me in the nuts, but I was already on the floor. I was sick like a junkie, she was far away. But I didn't wanna hurry and had thoughts down from my brain. So I cracked another beer. beer and I started for the road and I was thinking about leaving town again. Then something made me stop and turn my head around just like the sun out shining through the clouds. She had a head full of acid but her body was fantastic. I just hoped that she wouldn't mind drifting a while. Space on a ball, can't even control ourselves.
Here we are, welcome back. Here we are at What Keeps You Here, and you just heard the music from a dear friend of mine from many years ago. You probably didn't hear the whole song because I just realized I didn't have the right button pressed, DJ.
Uh-oh.
So at our next musical break, we're going to play it for him again. The name of the band was Bargain Bin Death Ray. We are in the studio today with Marek Kazmierski, and he is a literature person. How's that, Matic? Can I call you a literature person?
Yeah. That's pretty accurate. I guess of all the arts that I've been involved in, you know, making films, or, you know, setting up galleries and theater and various things and doing radio shows, I guess the role about narration and I guess the one that I feel closest to is stuff that's printed.
Okay. All right. So now we'd like to try to get into some of the actual narrations that you have worked on.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Is there something you would like to read to us today or talk about?
Yeah. I mean, I guess we're coming up for a very interesting period because what we talked about earlier, we talked about discrimination, we talked about disallowance, exclusion and disempowerment, you know, some of these words that actually there's a reason why we have them. They all mean different things. But one of the things that I noticed really was as a male, as a white male, I actually carry a lot of clout and I do feel, you know, that I have suffered discrimination in my life, but nowhere near as much as an equivalent woman coming from Poland would find in England. And so I started translating. I started translating a lot of poets, female poets, and I actually started enjoying it because I felt that their voice was more multidimensional. Mm. It was less, here's me, here's Hemingway, here's Bukowski, here's, you know, my kind of perspective. And it was more about telling me the story that I needed to hear. And so next week, there is the 100th anniversary of the birth of a lady called Sanna Paulina Ginzburg.
Say it again, I'm sorry.
She's actually known by her pen name, which is Zuzanna Ginczanka.
Ginczanka. Okay.
Ginzburg was easier, wasn't it? Ginzburg was easier. She's born in 1917 when Poland doesn't yet exist.
Aha, okay.
And she's born in Russia. And her father ends up in America. Her mother ends up in Spain. She ends up becoming a Polish poet. She chooses to write in Polish of all the languages she speaks. Mm-hmm. We need to remember that at that time, Europe was a real mess when it came to cultures and, you know, borders. And just after the First World War, and Russia was in upheaval and turmoil. And it's really amazing to think just, you know, 100 years ago that this territory looked so very, very different. And this young lady wrote some amazing poems. And then unfortunately, she suffered a tragic end, that she was murdered. She was betrayed and murdered by the Gestapo just before the war ended.
Oh, wow.
You know.
Okay.
And, but the really thing, the surprising thing is we haven't heard about her really, because even after her death, she was also forgotten. Or as I prefer to say, she was repressed. There was a lot of things about what she did that called for freedom and called for liberation and called for courage, which I think a lot of times we don't have as people. And so before I give you a shot of Ginczanka, which I hope I will get a chance to do.
Definitely.
I wanted to give a shout out to a wonderful poet who did survive the war, Irit, Amiel. She lives in Israel. She comes from Czeslaw, and I had the privilege of translating and having published last year by a wonderful publisher in Krakow called Austeria, a book of her poems in Polish and English.
Wonderful.
So I just want to read one poem by Irit Amiel from her book called Spóźniona, Delayed. And the Polish poem is called Mniej Zmarli, and the English translation goes like this. Less dead. As long as I am still here, you are less dead. But soon enough, you will die for the nth and last time. My end will finally wipe you from the face of the earth. For now, however, you are still beating within me, tattooed into memory, etched into my veins. Soon enough, I will take you down to Hades, into that final darkness, so you will rise from the dead no more. I will take with me all those names and songs, faces, smiles, miseries, worries, and tears. Every mask, memory, the missing of things, each escape, debasement, and late return. I will take you all to the grave, and we will stay there, more dead. We, the victims and the saved, of that wormwood bitter 20th century. And perhaps, finally, then we'll make our escape from noise and from sadness. We Jews of song, we Jews of madness.
Whoa.
All right.
That's and that heavy. Last line is taken from a poem by a wonderful guy called Julian Tuvim, who many of you will know from children's poetry. But yeah, that was a poem from a lady who lives on in Tel Aviv and who keeps writing and who survived that horrible period in our history. Mm-hmm. And I guess it's very important, I think, that we revisit some of those stories because some of that darkness is creeping over us again.
And I am so glad you said that. The darkness is creeping over us again. I'm really wondering, did it ever go away? Did it just go underground? It was
swept under the rug, it seems.
Exactly. Suppressed. I'm thinking of the United States more than anything, where laws were put in place to protect people. Did it really drive away these dark forces, or did it just hold them down long enough until now they're bursting?
You know, I often, when I lived in England for 30 years, everybody said, oh, Marek, you're so dark, you're so pessimistic, you're so Polish. And then when I moved here, you know, a year and a half ago, all the Polish people say, Marek, you're so optimistic, you're so happy, stop it, you're so English. And I kind of realized, you know what I mean? This is like, what's going on? And when I think about where we are today, I really do think if we do the sums, that there is progress, that there is evolution, and that the experience of my life compared to my father's or my grandfather's, both of my grandfathers did time in death camps, and both survived. One was a high-ranking officer, and one was a very hard-working radio operator, actually,
really?
For the Polish resistance. And he survived three death camps, extermination camps, at the very end when it really was, you know, just a death machine. And so I can't really, you know, say that my life is no better. But when I look at something like, for example, prisons in America, which we're, you know, looking at your country of origin, you know, last year we saw the release of a film called 13.
Yes.
Which is basically saying, no, slavery did not end. Today in America, there is more young black men in prison and for very long, long periods. And, you know, than there ever was slaves during the period of slavery in America. There is 3 million people behind the bars in America. One in three American males, if you're black, is going to do time behind bars. One in 10 is behind bars today. Those statistics are trying to tell us something, and that is slavery really didn't go away. It just became more insidious. And so there is a transformation, and you know, people aren't owned and people aren't killed outright, like
directly.
You know, but there is still shed loads of darkness in the human spirit, and there is still shed loads of need for us to keep challenging that through things like films, radio shows, and obviously poems.
Yeah. TV shows too sometimes. There's this show called Blackish, and they talk about all different aspects. It's a sitcom. It's think of the updated Cosby, basically.
Mm.
It's Cosby, the Cosby show for this decade, or probably longer, obviously. But they definitely, they just had an episode talking about the prison system, because one guy, the dad, didn't want to do jury duty, but then he started realizing that the guy there was black defendant, and the rest of the jury people were white, and he's over there like, huh, something doesn't seem right, because the the defendant, they're talking about how the defendants only get like 5 seconds per case to prepare, because they're just overwhelmed with work anyway. So this guy was just confusing one case for another trying to defend this guy, and yeah. So
I've not seen Blackish. Is it worth something? Is it something that we should look at?
Yes. They had a great episode on police brutality.
Aha.
Yeah, it was a moment where the dad, see, the mom, she's mixed, half and half, and had a way different upbringing. The dad, he was from Compton. They have 4 kids. Mm-hmm. 2 of the youngest, you know, they're young, and the mom kind of didn't want them to hear and see the whole situation, because everybody else, the teenagers, the dad, his mom, and his dad, they're always like, you know, the cops are going to get off for this, that's why this is happening already, blah blah blah. But the mom kept saying, no, we're trying to have hope. And then he brings up the first time Obama was elected, and he said, as soon as you saw Obama and both Obamas walking out of their car waving at everybody with no protection around them, tell me it didn't scare you. So you're not saying, get back in that car, get back in that car. And then they replayed that moment, and even I felt like, oh damn, I remember feeling that moment where I was like, get in the car, get back in that car. So they really tackled a lot of different things.
Yeah, and at the risk of saying something really bad right now, I've got to put it out there, there was an article I read recently from a webpage called Very Smart Brothers, and they said there is something called nigger neurosis, and nigger neurosis is what happens when I'm at a stoplight and a police car comes up behind me, and I know I've done nothing wrong, but there's that 0.9999% of me saying, what if? What if my taillight is out and he's going to beat me in the head and kill me?
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the neurosis kicks in. Being a black man in America, there is a neurosis.
Well, you know, this arriving and having worked in universities, having worked, you know, down the doors of nightclubs and worked in libraries and various places, you get to this stage, you think, you know, can I explain everything? And you know what? I think we can.
Yeah.
It's like, what is intuition, right? What is emotional intelligence?
Mm-hmm.
It's basically an accumulation of experiences that are combined with our intelligence, right? Our brains. It's a computer with a fast microchip and you know, big hard drive full of data. And so when you're experiencing that, what you're actually experiencing is the knowledge that somewhere, maybe you might have forgotten it, you're 27 more times likely, according to statistics, to be stopped and pulled over. You are a dozen times more likely to be shot and killed if your skin is different to the skin of the officer, right?
And being very well aware of that.
This is not paranoia. This is not neuroses. This is actually a survival tactic at a time when violence is not gone away. It's just been shoved into different communities who are involved in drugs, involved in crime, etc., which, again, for a long time we've done nothing creative to address. And the question is, if we haven't, is someone getting richer for this?
Well, of course they are. That's always been my stand on it, follow the money. Someone's getting very rich off the prison industrial complex.
Oh, yeah.
Getting very rich off of this insidious war on drugs. When I was a teenager and I would go somewhere in the car around my hometown of New Orleans, Louisiana, my mother was always terrified. And I could only at the time say, you got to calm down. You know, this is the 80s. Everything is okay. And I'm looking back at her nervousness of her black son, her young black son driving around the city or going into Mississippi, for example. In her childhood, going to Mississippi was a risk.
Oh, yeah.
So when I say I'm driving through there, she gets terrified. I couldn't understand it at the time. Now I do.
I have a similar thing. You know, I used to have hair, and you know, you try to have the waves, and you try to keep that as fresh as possible, right? So the 360 waves and all that. So you would go to sleep with the do-rag on because, one, it keeps, you know, the pillow would just dry out your hair. So it keeps it down, it keeps it moist enough, and you go to school looking real clean. But sometimes you're thinking, let me have this on while on the bus so it's as clean as possible, as fresh as possible, right?
To the last moment, right.
My dad always freaked out if I tried to walk out of the house wearing that. And I'm like, what's your problem with this? I'm just going straight to the bus to school.
Mm.
And, but it took me some years to realize that the image of having just a do-rag would already set some people off.
Mm.
And it's like, damn. We can't do nothing, can we?
Yeah, you're judged from the moment you step out. I want to go back to something, too, that Maddox said earlier about feeling like an outsider when you first got to London. It's interesting for me to hear that from you because you said your name was different, but you look to me like someone from London.
Mm-hmm.
Do Londoners know you're not? Do Brits look at you and say, he's not one of us?
Never mind accidentally wearing a Polish eagle on your helmet.
minus the Polish eagle on your helmet.
It absolutely. I mean, I went to a very good school in West London, and then I ended up going to a very good all-girls school for 2 years.
Oh.
Because the Catholic community had this exchange program. So I went to an all-boys school for 3 years. And then doing my pre-university exams, I had the option of doing some courses at the all-girls school. The Gumley House Convent School for Girls.
Gumley.
150 years old, run by nuns. Yeah. So it was just like Dead Poets Society. It was just like, you know.
That's what I was like, I see nuns with
just put 1,200 girls.
Put your hand out, hit the ruler. You know.
1,200 girls in one place. And I tell you, it sounds like a dream come true. But in the first year, there was 28 of us joined up for this tour of duty in this all girls. And by the end of the second year, by the end of the first year, there's only 10 of us left. It was a hard, you know, tour of duty.
In the words of the wise Fresh Prince, girls are nothing but trouble.
Too much of a good thing. And of course, yes, instantly I realized I had a motorcycle. I was big. I did a lot of sports when I was in Poland because under communism, schools were special schools for musically talented kids, mathematically talented kids, and physically talented kids, and they would try to create these Übermenschen, you know, these super beings that proved that communism was better, and that if, you know, there were sports people from Russia and Poland, they would be better than the West, and if there was musical concerts, they'd be better. If there was ballet, they'd be better. And so I was big and I was strong. But I suddenly realized that doesn't matter. I don't have floppy hair. I don't have the right accent.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have the subtle tweaks that tell you, you come from my class. You come from my level and you are welcome in my house. And what you do realize in England is that in Poland, you don't have this. In Poland, all over Poland, people speak the same accent.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And class exists in Poland. And it's staggeringly, to me now, obvious that what the communists tried to do with Poland is in trying to eradicate the old division between the landowners, the nobility, and the serfs, you know, the peasants, that a lot of that was hidden. And I think some of that was achieved. But when I look around Warsaw today, when I look around some of the cities, you do really see people who look like they own stuff. And they look elegant, and they look more elegant. The men here, they're like little peacocks, you know, some of the Polish blokes I see. I'm thinking, how much time did you spend getting ready today, you know, choosing the shoelaces of your handmade shoes? And then you see all the people on the bus stops and drinking, and, you know, and you're thinking, my, you know, they look like something from a medieval painting, you know. You kind of realize the communists didn't manage to achieve this equality of social opportunity. But in England, all you have to do is open your mouth. And if I want to sound like I'm from East London, if I'm speaking to people, if I'm speaking to gangsters and I don't want to sound too posh, I can make myself sound like I come from Peckham. But if I want to impress the right people and send out the right message, I can then twist and act in a way which suddenly makes them feel, okay, yes, we can talk to this chap. Mm-hmm. He's okay. He's one of us.
Code switching.
Yeah, code switching.
In England, absolutely. This is a very powerful thing. They say you could be dressed like a tramp, but the moment you open your mouth, you'll get respect if you speak with the right accent and vice versa. You could look like $1 million, but if you open your mouth and you sound a bit like this, no one's going to take you seriously, bruv, yeah? Doesn't matter how much bling you got.
Mm-hmm. Accents in London, accents in the UK really do give you an idea of where the person is from to a certain degree. Mm-hmm. Whereas in the States, it's a little different. I mean, we do have accents, for example, but it doesn't necessarily recognize your financial status or your class. You know, there are some buffoons who are worth millions of dollars. I'm not going to give a name because we all know who this person is. But he's
he's worth less than you are. And his problem, of course, is not how much he owns. It's not his business dealings. It's not his wealth. It's his debts.
That's not talked about.
It is being talked about now when they're suddenly realizing he's in hock to the Germans and the Russians.
Yes, he is.
This is not necessarily good for the freedom and liberty. Do you know what I mean?
The truth is rising up, so to say.
Finally.
I'm looking. We're going to take another quick break, you guys, and we're going to come back and have more of our discussion with Marek Kazmierski. I'm going to play that song for you once more just to make sure that you heard it, because I know I missed it on the first time. I didn't have the right button pressed. I'm sorry about that, Mike.
Well, someone said great song, so
maybe they did hear it. Hey, okay, what I'll do, we'll play two songs at this break then. I'll play a little bit of a song from Bargain Bin Death Rate, and the name of it is Tubal Cain Blues. I love it. And we'll play a second song. We'll let DJ choose the song for the second one. You're listening to What Keeps You Here. We are back with What Keeps You Here, and we're in the studio right now with Matic. And Matic, could you tell us a little bit about what are some of the projects that you're doing, as well as what may be going on here in Warsaw insofar as the literature scene is concerned?
Warsaw, Poland,
I guess the stories that are to be found here in this rather strange corner of the world, that actually most people, I think, understand or know about very little. And I don't know what your experience is of your friends, you know, back home in America, thinking, where did you guys end up? But certainly England, where you'd imagine people would have some semblance of awareness of what Central and West and Eastern Europe is. Actually, when you test that knowledge, you find that it's, you know, smaller than it should be.
Really?
So my mission is to try and put on the map some of the writing that has been done in Polish. And I'm finding that it's actually very difficult, because in Poland, if you look at all the books published every year, 27-28% is translated from other languages into Polish. Mm-hmm. So every third book sold every year in Poland is translated from another world language. So Polish people are interested in the voices of others,
but not in their own.
No. Two-thirds is Polish.
So
the majority, and then a third is other languages. If you look at England and America, that drops by tenfold. So it's 3%. And actually, if you look at the statistics that they've done in America, it's 0.7%, because it's all the poetry and prose and novels and things only make up less than 1% of all the books published every year.
Okay.
So there is, again, talking about cultural colonialism and, you know, identity dominance and all that stuff. This is scary, scary news. And Polish people have a very strong respect for books. They have a strong respect for learning. They do think that names such as the science fiction writer Stanisław Lem and Krzysztof Kapuściński, the writer of Reportage, and various poets who won the Nobel Prize, like Szymborska and Miłosz, that they are big names in the international language community. And I don't think they are. When I look at the sales figures, they are very worrying. So I came to Poland to learn more about how I can do a better job of exporting Polish writing into English.
Okay. And how did you land on Ginczanka?
It was 2 years ago. So I started reading and I started learning, and I obviously learned a lot about the Holocaust and some of the kind of tragic histories. And it was through a friend of mine called Bogdan Frumorgan, who is a photographer, and he worked in a BBC Radio World Service for 20 years. Through him, I met a friend who is called Zuzanna, and who, Lipińska, who's coming here next week. And she introduced me to this incredible poem called Not All of Me Will Die, mm-hmm. by Zuzanna Ginczanka, which is remarkable, not just because it's a remarkable work of art, but because it's the only poem that survives her from the time that she spent hiding from the Germans during the war. And it's also the only work of art we know of that's been used successfully in an international court of human rights to prosecute somebody for crimes against humanity. So in this poem, she names the people who betrayed her to the Germans, and those people were then sentenced after the war and received prison sentences for
colluding. She named them in her poetry.
She does indeed, yes.
Wow. Wow.
And so I think the legacy of this woman is something that we really need to revisit, and we really need to go back to. And that's going to be a major part of the next, you know, however many years of my life.
Would you like to read some of it to us now?
Yeah, this poem is, I guess, her last poem. So maybe it's not a good place to start, because I've translated a lot of her early work, and some of it is really fun, and some of it is really sexy, and some of it is really jokey. But I guess the one that everybody knows in Polish, not in English translation, is Not All of Me Will Die.
Not all of me will die.
Not my proud estate, meadow tablecloths, wardrobe castles strong, acres of fine bedsheets, linen treasures great, and dresses, light dresses, these are my swan song. Because I leave behind not a single heir, let your hungry hands through my Jew things browse. Miss Homin of Lviv, landlady betrayer, Nazi true informant, if conscience allows. You and your loved ones recall my name and face as you remembered me when the Gestapo came, minding to lead them to my hiding place. They recognized me then, now remember again, as you drink to my grave and supposed wealth, fine drapes, candlesticks, my remains your prize. Goblets raise, friends, to your lasting health. Drink all night, drink. And when the cockerel cries, start hunting for gemstones, digging round for gold, through my mattresses, sofas, furnishings, what may the bounty you seek hold, the treasures you want hold, as you go tearing through stuffed horsehair and hay. Feathers ripped from cushions, clouds of gutted quilts, will snow upon your hands, turn your arms to wings. Pure white down will bind, with my blood congealed, letting you take flight, my angels, my kings.
Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you for sharing that today with us. Tell me the poet's name again.
It is Zuzanna Ginczanka. If you visit www.ginczanka.org, you will see a test version of a website which I've created for her. Because the tragic truth, of course, is that the tragedy doesn't finish with her death. We don't know where she was buried. We don't know what happened to her body. There is no grave. There is no museum. There is no archive. And what is worst of all, there are no books. That every 10, 20 years, somebody remembers her name. Somebody discovers this poem. Somebody goes somewhere, gets some money, publishes a selection of these poems. And then those books are sold. They become what's called white ravens. In Polish, this metaphor, this name, white raven, is a book or a work of art that's so rare it cannot be bought. And her books are all pretty much white ravens. So the mission that we're on now is to try and make sure that never happens again. So the website, which will be launching on the 9th of March, which is the 100th anniversary of her birth. So you're celebrating your birthday pretty much at the same time. is going to be an attempt to try and start something called the second century of Sana, which is looking at the problems of why she is unknown, why she is forgotten, why she is buried, and we don't even know where, and what we can do using our creative endeavors and intelligence to make sure that she is never forsaken again. And we're working on film, we're working on music, we're working on even things like children's books. This is on the idea of taking one of her early poems and doing it like a handmade book that anybody can download and print off at home and sit with their children and bind the book and color it in and illustrate it and even write more verses, is an attempt to say no more forgetting. Because when we forget the lessons of these horrible, horrible days, what happens is the evil goes to sleep for a while.
Yes,
but
indeed.
Then it comes back and bites us on our very opinionated backsides. And we really can't afford to have that happening again, especially now as we enter into a world of, you know, artificial intelligence, robotics, you know, quantum computing, and of course still the threat of some very, very powerful weapons hanging over us.
Mm-hmm. Marek, this has been a wonderful discussion with you today. I am so grateful to have met you. This is my first time actually meeting you, for all of you who are listening. Are there any events coming up, Matic, as we close, that you can tell people there where they can meet you or hear you? Or
there certainly are. This week, on Wednesday and Thursday in Krakow, there is a group of wonderful Karolina and Sylvia. Big shout out to you and the efforts you've put in to try and celebrate Ginczanka. There's going to be a conference discussion. There will be an unveiling of a plaque on the building where she was taken by the Gestapo and killed, which these girls have organized.
And this is in Krakow.
This is in Krakow, the last place where she was. She hid from the Nazis. And there will be a poetry reading in Bonar, a bookshop. There will be a performance of Ginczanka's Room or Pokój, a performance organized by Theater Studio, which is on right now, I think, at Poland, at the Museum of Jewish History, and is going to be coming to Krakow on Thursday evening in the house that she lived in Warsaw. One of my great friends, Gabriela von Seltman, is organizing a concert of a beautiful project called Żar Ptak, Firebird, which is her poems, Ginczanka's poems set to song. On Friday, we're trying to organize a Shabbat or a Sabbath for Ginczanka in Powiśle with some of my friends, Marcin Latało and a few other people from Warszawa. So we are doing what we can to try and organize workshops with book binding and performance and education to try and make sure that whatever mistakes we've made in the past in trying to make sure that this person's legacy and work doesn't go unnoticed, that we do not repeat those mistakes in the future.
One quick question. I remember about that poem, you mentioned that this was actually used in courts?
Yes, yeah. This was right after the war in Warsaw. There were obviously courts to hold to account those who collaborated with the Nazi occupiers. And one of those people was Miss Chominova, who's named in the poem, who lived in Lviv, which is now in Ukraine, and who betrayed many people, including Ginczanka, to the, you know, German authorities, and who was sentenced and received a 4-year sentence, and she did 4 years hard time for her crime.
Nice.
And this is why we know about this poem. This poem was kind of saved from being lost in the fire of the war, because it was used in this hearing and it was documented. And the original copy is now kind of lost, but we do have a few copies survived, and thanks to that, we can now translate them into different languages, French and Ukrainian, and make sure that the world hears about Ginczanka.
Very good. Nice. We have, looking at the old clock, we have run out of time. Marek, thank you very much for being our guest today.
Huge pleasure.
Fascinating.
Marek Kazmierski. Yeah?
I think I was close.
Happy birthday to you, Virgil.
Thank you very much, man. Thank you very much. I turned 25 today, everybody.
Beautiful age.
Yeah.
For the third time now?
For the third time now. I was 25 last year. No, okay. Thank you, DJ. Any parting words? Who's our guest next week?
Our guest will be Gary Lysett,
Yeah, I think it's Lysett. Sorry, Gary, for messing up your name. You know you're listening to us. Gary will be our guest next week. Gary has something very interesting. He's of British descent, and he currently works as a teacher in Warsaw, and he hosts a DJ night in Warsaw called Lunatech, in which everyone is welcome to come along, have fun, and dance their heart's content.
Good, good. And just a FYI, all of our recorded shows that we have not lost will be on YouTube now. YouTube. So look us up.
Thank you.
WKYH on Emmy Radio YouTube.
And we're closing out with What Keeps You Here. Thank you for joining us. We're going to close out with a little Earth, Wind, and Fire. Where have all the flowers gone? Bye, everybody.